Now, the next presenter is Konstantinos. He's going to present Smash, a work that he presented in Micro 2019. Smash is a hardware software collaborative mechanism for highly efficient indexing and storage of sparse matrices. As you will see, Smash improves performance and energy of a sparse linear algebra, and it can be applicable to important modern workloads like graph processing or sparse neural networks. Konstantinos, are you ready?
Yes, can you make me a presenter?
Yeah, I think Jason will do.
Yes, you are now co-host.
Can you all see my screen?
Yes, we can see.
Oh yeah. So thanks Juan a lot for the introduction. So I'm Konstantinos. I'm studying at Etihad Zurich in Safari as a PhD student. So I'm going today to present to you SMAS, co-designing software compression and hardware accelerated indexing for efficient sparse matrix operations. So as Juan said, this is a mechanism that like is able to accelerate important sparse linear algebra workloads. And this paper is this work is a collaboration between Safari members from Etihad Zurich and Carnegie Mellon University. So let's dive into the executive summary of our work. So many important workloads heavily involve and make use of sparse matrices. And in these workloads, the matrices that are used are extremely sparse. So compression is an essential tool. So let me share my camera also. Sorry. Yeah. Many important workloads, as I said, heavily make use of sparse matrices. So these matrices are extremely sparse, and compression is an essential tool to avoid storage and computational overheads. So there's existing compression formats, SARO, from several shortcomings. So first, they require the expensive discovery of the positions of non-zero elements, or they offer narrow applicability. They cannot be applied to a wide range of sparse matrices. So in this work, we present SMASH, which is a hardware-software cooperative mechanism for efficient sparse matrix storage and computation. So the key idea in SMASH is to co-design software and hardware in a way to enable hardware to recognize and exploit the sparsity in the data. So SMASH comprises of two key components. So on the software side, we use an efficient compression scheme that utilizes a hierarchy of bitmaps to find the positions of non-zero elements. And on the hardware side, we employ a hardware unit that interprets the bitmap hierarchy, and this way we're able to accelerate indexing. So SMASH offer performance improvements on average 38% on SPMV and 44% on SPMM, which are two really important workloads. And the performance compared to the existing state-of-the-art format, which is the CSR format. We conclude that SMASH can be highly efficient, low cost, and widely applicable across a wide range of applications. First, here's the outline of my talk. So first, I'm going to start by giving some background on sparse matrices. Then I will present our proposed mechanism, and after that I'm going to dig into the evaluation results and finally conclude. So sparse matrix operations are widespread today. So they're critical components of application domains like recommender systems and applications like collaborative filtering, graph analytics, and applications like PageRank, breadth-first search, and between a centrality, as well as neural nets and sparse DNNs and graph neural networks, sparse neural networks. So in these real world matrices that used in these applications have extremely high sparsity. As you can see here, Facebook's and YouTube's connectivity graphs have a really, really low amount of non-zero elements compared to the whole adjacency matrix. So we conclude that sparse matrix compression can be is essential to enable efficient storage and computation on top of these really sparse data structures. So we will now discuss the existing compression formats and their shortcomings. Existing compression formats suffer from the following shortcomings. First, there are some like general compression formats which are trying to optimize for low storage and high compression ratios. The problem with these formats and their shortcoming is that they require an expensive discovery of the positions of non-zero elements. So even though they're able to compress really effectively the sparse matrix, they require expensive computation to find which are the non-zero elements. So first, in this presentation, we're going to dive in this class of formats, and then we're going to talk about the second one. So the most widely used format sparse matrix compression is the compressed sparse row. It's used in multiple frameworks and libraries like the Intel MKL, which is the state-of-the-art library right now in sparse linear algebra, the TACO compiler, LIGRA, Polymer, which are graph processing benchmarks. The main property of CSR is that it stores only the non-zero elements of the sparse matrix, but and it also provides this way a really high compression ratio. So let's dive into the, let me explain how CSR works, the basics of CSR, and then I will explain where this indexing overhead coming from, and I will give a definition to what is indexing. So we see here on the left a sparse matrix A. So a sparse matrix A has many zero elements. So the CSR format compresses this sparse matrix using three arrays. So it uses the row pointer, the column index, and the values. So the row pointer holds the number of zero elements per row. The column index holds the column index of each one of the non-zero elements in this row, and the values array gives the non-zero values of the sparse matrix. So from our understanding, so finding out the position of this specific element, we have element three here, we need to first access the row pointer to find to which row it belongs to. And then we need to find out in the column index that it's the second element. It's in column two, starting from a zero index. So, and then we need to access the values array to find out which is the value of the element. So as you can understand, this requires multiple instructions to discover the positions of the non-zero element. And these instructions are data dependent because we need to find first, we need to iterate over the rows and then iterate over the columns to find out the values of the elements. So let's see what is the indexing overhead in these sparse kernels, in major sparse kernels. So let's talk first about sparse matrix vector multiplication, which is one of the most important kernels in sparse linear algebra and in multiple applications right now. So in this case, we would need indexing for every non-zero element of the sparse matrix to multiply with the corresponding element of the vector. So in this case, we need to find out the position of which non-zero element to find out with which element we need to multiply it from the vector. Also, sparse matrix multiplication, we have two sparse matrices and we need index matching for every net product between the two sparse matrices. So let me remind you that in sparse matrix multiplication, we have two sparse matrices and we need to multiply to perform each inner product between sparse vectors to find out the final result. So as we can understand, indexing is really expensive for the major sparse matrix kernels. So let's see an example here. So we have the SCSR based SPMV and we're gonna describe how we perform the indexing. First, we need to iterate over the row pointer. So as we can see, we need to go to the row pointer and then find out how many elements do I have in my row. Let's say that I have two elements. Then I need to go into the column index and search for these two elements, find their column indices and utilize these indices to perform the correct multiplication with the corresponding elements of the vector. So as we can see, SPMV will require indexing, which means discovering the position of every non-zero element. So let's dive into how we perform this indexing in the sparse matrix multiplication. So as you can see on the left, we have two matrices, matrix A and matrix B. So as you can see, elements A and D are in the same column and row, B and E the same, but C and F are not. So we should not multiply C and F to perform the inner product. So how would we do that? We need to compare the column index with the row index of matrix B, like the row index is a reverse thing. And we find out that they have the same number. So this means that we need to multiply A and D. Then we need to do the same for B and E. And then we also need to do the same for C and F. And we find out that C and F should not be multiplied because they don't have the same values, right? So as we can understand, the SPMM requires indexing for every possible element in during the inner product, which is really expensive. And it's dominated by that, as we will see. So to better understand the indexing bottleneck, we conducted some experiments where we perform indexing with zero cost. So this means that the processor is not paying anything, and it's not paying anything for computation or memory accesses that have to do with indexing. So in this figure, we demonstrate the performance achieved by the zero indexing scheme compared to the default CSR implementation. And we evaluated three workloads you can see in the x-axis: sparse matrix addition, sparse matrix vector multiplication, and sparse matrix matrix multiplication. And the results are averaged across a set of 15 matrices. And as we observe, for all the workloads, the ideal CSR scheme results in performance, the zero cost indexing scheme results in performance improvement, especially in SPMM, where this indexing is really intense. So it turns out that reducing the cost of indexing is able to accelerate sparse matrix operations significantly. So coming back to the compression formats, the second class of formats are like some specialized formats that assume specific structures and patterns like diagonals. These formats, unfortunately, are not general and they offer narrow applicability. So we cannot apply them to a wide range of sparse matrices. So what is our goal in this work? So our goal is to design a sparse matrix compression that minimizes the index overheads, can be used across a wide range of sparse matrices and sparse matrix operations, and also enables really high compression ratios. So to this end, we propose SMASH. The key idea to address the limitations of the existing compression formats, we propose SMASH, which is a hardware-software cooperative mechanism that enables highly efficient sparse matrix compression and computation, and is general across a diverse set of sparse matrices and sparse matrix operations. So on the software side, SMASH employs an efficient compression scheme using a hierarchy of bitmaps. And on the hardware side, we employ a bitmap unit that scans the bitmaps to accelerate indexing. And software is able to manipulate the functionality of the hardware unit. So software and hardware are able to communicate together using an interface, which is called the SMASH ISA. This is a set of ISA primitives. So let's dive into the software compression scheme first. So the software compression scheme in SMASH is able to encode the positions of the non-zero elements using bits to maintain low storage overhead. If we maintain low storage overhead, we perform less computation. That's the key takeaway. So the core data structure behind our compression scheme is a bitmap. The bitmap data structure is able to encode whether a block, a series of elements of the matrix, contain any zero element. So right now, I'm going to show you an example of a bitmap compressing a sparse matrix. So on the left, you can see a matrix which is divided into grids, and on the right you can see the bitmap. So the first block of the matrix is a non-zero block. This means that this block of the matrix contains at least one non-zero element. So this means that we set the bit into the first block, into the first position of the bitmap. So the next few elements of the sparse matrix are zero blocks. This means that they only contain zero elements, and we use zero bits in the bitmap. As we observe, this way we follow this algorithm to create the whole bitmap, right? And as we observe, depending on the block size, the bitmap hierarchy might contain a high number of zero bits. So one simple idea is to apply the same encoding to compress even more effectively. This is a lossy format and we are approximate, right? So the idea is, can we compress more effectively to have more storage benefits and perform less computation? So we demonstrate a simplified example of what we call a hierarchy of bitmaps. So in this example, the original matrix contains three non-zero blocks. So we store these three non-zero blocks contiguously in memory using a data structure called non-zero values array, NZA. So based on these positions of these non-zero blocks, we first create the bitmap zero. Set bits in the bitmap zero represents non-zero blocks and the code, their respective positions in the sparse matrix. So for example, you can see here that the first four bits of the bitmap zero correspond to the first four blocks of the matrix, and we have a set bit and a non-zero block. So we recursively build the higher levels of the bitmap hierarchy, and we use bitmap one that encodes a 4-bit block of bitmap zero and bitmap two that encodes a 2-bit block of bitmap one. And as we see, the compression ratio across the levels of the hierarchy can be different. And this can be, uh, th- this is this can be custom for every different sparse matrix, right? So we need to do a search to understand which is the best compression ratio. One advantage of the hierarchy of bitmaps is that you do not need to keep in memory this, the blocks of the bitmaps that are completely zero. And as we see in this example, bitmap zero has two blocks that contain only zero bits. So these blocks are not kept in memory. So let's discuss about the algorithm, how we can traverse and find the positions of the non-zero elements. So to find out the positions of the non-zero elements, we need to perform a depth first traversal into the hierarchy of bitmaps. You can find more details about the index calculation in the paper, but essentially what we need to do is we need to go and recursively access the hierarchy of bitmaps and determine the position of the non-zero element. This can be done in parallel, but we discuss more about that in the paper. So as I mentioned before, one of the advantages of the hierarchy of bitmaps is that it does not store in memory the zero blocks of the sparse matrix and the bitmaps. Due to that, we have a storage efficient compression scheme that enables fast indexing. So in this case, we do not need to scan the zero blocks. We're able to scanning these bitmaps requires bitwise operations, which makes the hierarchy of bitmaps really amenable, hardware friendly, and amenable to hardware acceleration, as we will show. So I'm now going to present the hardware acceleration unit of SMASH. SMASH employs a hardware unit that scans the bitmap hierarchy to perform indexing and quickly determine the positions of the non-zero elements. This bitmap management unit interprets the bitmap hierarchy using software and buffers and scans the bitmap hierarchy using bitwise operations. The hardware unit used in SMASH is called Bitmap Management Unit, BMU. So in our case, the CPU queries the BMU to determine the positions of the non-zero elements. And the BMU consists of four key components. It uses SRAM buffers that holds the bitmaps and the whole hierarchy of bitmaps, one for each level of the hierarchy. It uses programmable registers that hold parameters of the matrix and the parameters of the bitmap hierarchy, and also registers that hold the row and the column index of the current non-zero block. We also employ a hardware logic that scans the buffers, reads the parameters, and updates the row and column indices so that the CPU is able to receive them. So to enable indexing multiple matrices across the same application, for example, the BMU contains multiple groups of these components. So we're going to talk right now about the interface between the CPU and this bitmap management unit. So we have a need for a cross-layer interface that enables software to control the bitmap management unit. So first, we need to communicate the parameters needed to calculate the index. We also need to query the BMU to retrieve the index of the next non-zero element. So we introduce a new set of five ISA instructions and this ISA enables SMASH to flexibly accelerate a diverse range of operations on any sparse matrix. So we can use the ISA and express many applications using it. So I'm giving you one example use case here, which is sparse matrix vector multiplication. So as I said before, in sparse matrix vector multiplication, we need to iterate over each of the non-zero blocks in the non-zero values array. So in this case, the CPU will request from the row and the column index from each non-zero block from the BMU to index the input vector and the output vector. So first, we will cache the three levels of hierarchy of the bitmap hierarchy into the BMU, and then we perform the bitwise operations to scan and find in every step the new position of the non-zero element and index the vector. So we need to stream through the non-zero blocks, for each one of the non-zero blocks access the BMU, and then index the vector using the BMU output. So let's go into the evaluation section. So let's talk first about our evaluation methodology. So you use the ZSIM microarchitectural simulator. And in terms of workloads, you use the sparse matrix kernel SPMV and SPMM from the TACO library, which is open source. And we also evaluated graph applications like PageRank and Between a Centrality from Ligra. So we formulated these as SPMV and SPMM. In terms of input data sets, we use a set of 15 diverse sparse metrics and 4 graphs from the sparse suite collection. So you can find our implementation in our GitHub repository. So in our evaluation, we examined 15 matrices with sparsity ranging from 0.01% up to 8.79% to have a wide range of densities in our evaluation. And in this figure, we demonstrate the speedup of SMAS and TACO BCSR. BCSR is another state-of-the-art format over TACO CSR. And in the x-axis, we see 4 different workloads, SPMV, SPMM, PageRank, and between a centrality. And as we observe, SMAS provides significant performance improvement over the state-of-the-art format, up to 44%. So let's find out the reason why this happens. So in this figure, we demonstrate the number of executed instructions of SMAS and TACO BCSR over TACO CSR. And as we see, the reason is that like SMAS is able to significantly reduce the number of executed instructions. This happens because we remove from the pipeline everything that has to do with indexing like data dependent instructions, and the BMU is right now responsible for this. So we performed additional experiments where we sweep through matrices with ascending order based on their sparsity. And as we observed in this case, for this set of 15 matrices with increasing densities, SMAS provides speedups regardless of the density of the matrix. Of course, we need to be careful about the sparsity. It's not like we're going to accelerate any kind of sparse matrix. There are multiple other traits of the matrix that play a role into that. So let's talk about storage efficiency. So as we can understand, SMAS is able to efficiently compress sparse matrices on top of CSR, which is why we have performance benefits. Because if you compress more and you have lower storage requirements, then you are able to compute less. So in this paper, we also calculated the hardware area overhead of SMAS, more specifically of the bitmap management unit. So we have support for 4 matrices in the bitmap management unit, 256 bytes per SRAM buffer, and 140 bytes for registers and counters. So we have a 0.076 area overhead, percent area overhead over an Intel Xeon CPU, which is actually negligible. You can find other results into the paper, like compression ratio sensitivity analysis for different matrices, distribution of non-zero elements, detailed results for sparse matrix multiplication, what is the overhead of converting from CSR to the SMAS format, the hierarchy of bitmaps, and some software-only approach where we execute only using the hierarchy of bitmaps in software. So I will now conclude my talk. So many important, as I said before, many important workloads heavily make use of sparse matrices. Matrices in these workloads are extremely sparse, and compression can be an essential tool to avoid storage and computational overheads. So existing compression formats have several shortcomings. First, they incur expensive discovery of the positions of non-zero elements, and also they might have narrow applicability. So in this work, we introduced SMAS, a hardware-software cooperative mechanism for efficient sparse matrix storage and computation. SMAS has 2 components. On the software side, we use an efficient compression scheme using a hierarchy of bitmaps. And on the hardware side, we employ a hardware unit that interprets this hierarchy and accelerates indexing. SMAS is able to provide 38% and 44% on average performance improvement for SPMV and SPMM respectively over the widely used CSR format. We conclude that SMAS can be a highly efficient, low cost, and widely applicable mechanism. It can be an important tool for multiple applications as like sparse neural networks, sparse convolutional neural networks, and multiple sparse workloads. So, do you have any questions? Because we will proceed with some discussion. Okay. I will start with the discussion. So, some research questions are like, how does SMAS work when the algorithm traverses the matrix in an irregular way? Let's say that we have a sparse matrix and we want to access or we want to search through elements in an irregular fashion. So right now, SMAS is really good at streaming through the matrix. So we need extra support for being able to access the matrix in an irregular way. There are some like irregular applications which do not access the matrix in a stream manner like SPMV and SPMM. They might access it in an irregular way. Is there a way to remove the decompression from the critical path? Are we able to overlap or pre-decompress so that we're able to perform the decompression in a much faster way? So can we use in memory bitwise operations to find which operations result in zeros before the execution? So what is our goal, right? So we have two sparse matrices, and our goal is to find out which are the products that will end up in zero. Is there a way and any like format or any algorithm that can give us, can pre-compute these results so that we avoid it during the execution? How do we determine the bitmap parameters on the fly? So right now in this paper, to compute the bitmap parameters and the compression ratios between the different levels in the hierarchy, we did a brute force search. And so we find out that like some specific parameters might work for these matrices. But like, is there a way to systematically find out which are these bitmap parameters? Also, can we use a similar mechanism in GPUs or any kind of accelerators or integrate it in any kind of accelerators to perform this indexing part and accelerate potentially the workload in a better way? So we can discuss all these, like if someone is interested, we can discuss all this through a meeting or from Piazza, or you can contact me directly. So I have some new directions in mind in terms of sparse workloads. So I'm working right now, we're working on two different directions, metadata management and traversal scheduling. So I'm going to talk briefly about this. So what is metadata management? So there is a paper published from the group in ISCA 2018. It's called The Case for Richer Cross-Layer Abstractions Bridging the Semantic Gap with Expressive Memory. It's from Nandita Vijayakumar, who is right now a professor in University of Toronto. What this paper suggested is like a way where we can transfer data from software to hardware, high-level semantic information of software, like the memory access pattern, hot-cold regions, approximability, and any kind of high-level semantic information of a data structure to hardware, so that we can design more efficient and more intelligent memory optimizations. So some research questions that I would like, that are really, I'm really interested in, is that like, what kind of high-level semantic information are needed to enable efficient memory optimizations in sparse workloads? Like, is the memory access pattern, is the size of the data structures, is the cold-hot access frequency, is the structure of the graph or of the sparse matrix? And what kind of memory optimizations can we enable using this high-level semantic information? So this is a pair of questions that we need to answer together. And after we ask these questions and we answer them, and we find out some really important memory optimizations, the question is, how can we perform low-cost metadata management without introducing performance overheads? So another technique that has been proposed recently in a top-tier conference in the computer architecture community is the traversal scheduling in graph analytics. So it was a group from MIT who published that in Micro 2018. So the main goal of this work is the following. So in graph analytics, there is a hidden temporal locality which cannot be exploited using the current traversals that they employ in software. So let me dive a bit more into that. So the current approach is perform a numerical vertex ordered traversal. So we go from vertex 0 to 1 to 2 to 3, 4, 5, and we process the neighbors of these. But the problem is that like the graphs do not have this numerical semantic information, do not align with this. So performing the graph traversal in this numerical order does not align at all with the community-driven semantics of the graph input. And we need to find a way to traverse more intelligently. So what these authors proposed is a state-of-the-art approach right now in a computer architecture, and it's like heuristic-based. So it's called HATS from Micro 2018, as I said again. And their goal is to detect communities online or during runtime. How? Using a heuristic-based bounded depth-first search approach. So they use depth-first search to find the communities. And they support this algorithm, this heuristic, with a hardware accelerator to accelerate the community search. So the core executes the graph application, and it queries Hatch, their mechanism, to provide the next to be visited mechanism to the next to be visited vertex. And Hatch runs a bounded DFS engine to provide this information back to the core. And as you can understand, this is like this depth first search approach is a general, it's not a general mechanism, it's a custom heuristic for some graph applications. So there is a need for a fundamental and robust reordering technique. So I'm really interested into these research directions, and if someone is also interested, we can talk and have a meeting and brainstorm together, or I can show you more. Thanks. Any questions are welcome.
There is a question in the chat, Konstantinos.
Yeah, let me check. One moment. It's called exploiting a locality through traversal reordering. Let me put the slide again. It's this one. The slides will be uploaded, of course, so you will find it. Like there is much more work on that, and like I can share with you more papers if you're interested. Like many other techniques that try to solve the same problem.
Okay, any other questions? If there are no other questions, then I think we can move to the next presentation. Thank you very much, Konstantinos. Very good job.